social science division based in Erie. He has been living in the States for 22 years, if I'm not mistaken. And now he's working out of Los Banos, and his specialization is on commodity modeling, trade and policy analysis, future markets. And this afternoon, he will bring us a talk entitled The World in 2020-2035, How Much We Need, Who Will Produce It. Dr. Manjit, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm back here again in the second session here, but I have a different role to play here. I thought I have an easy presentation because I'm going to talk about 2020-2035. You cannot really come back and challenge me, I was wrong, because I'm the retired of them. But you can come back and ask Eric or Chukia after 6 months that they were all wrong on what they said. But I thought I have an easy one to talk about. Anyway, what I'm going to focus mostly on the longer term horizon and look at more supply-demand imbalances rather than looking at the outlook thing. But before that, this is my outline for my presentations. I'll give a very brief current state of affairs, because to need to know what happened 20, 30 years down the road, you need to know where you were, how you got here. So I'm going to talk very briefly about the current state of affairs. Looking ahead in 2020 and 2035, I focus mostly on the changing consumption pattern due to income growth and organizations, and they talk about the supply side story and kind of look at whether do we have any imbalances between supply and demand. And looking ahead in 2020 and 2035, then I'll conclude with a few remarks. This is where we are right now and how we got here. This is a slide my DG used very regularly, and a lot of things goes to easy because you can see there the real rice prices have gone down quite rapidly throughout the 70s and 80s and throughout the 90s, and we have the lowest price in first part of the century, around the real rice price, around $200 rice price there. The reason, because the production growth throughout the 70s, 80s and 90s has exceeded the population growth and resulting in a real decline in the rice prices there. Then we have, just to give the significance of the rice in the poverty reduction, this is just an example of what has happened in different states in India. On your vertical axis is the poverty ratio and the horizontal axis is the rice yield. You can see between 83 and 2005, as the rice yield has increased, it is clearly linked with the decline in the poverty ratio. So rice, we already heard quite a bit this morning, the significance of rice. We already heard what rice can do and what rice has done to the Asian economy in the last 50 years. So there is no argument that rice has a significant role to play if we ever want to eliminate poverty in Asia and Africa. Still, you know, with all these achievements, we still have a long way to go. We still have 1.4 billion people, or more than billion people, below poverty line all over the world, particularly concentrated in South Asia and parts of China here, also in Africa there. So in terms of achievements, I think we have a long way to go in terms of eliminating poverty from this planet here. Then we had this crisis, or whatever you call rice spike, or whatever you say that. We had this increase in rice prices in 2007, late 2007, early 2008, and the price kind of touched $1,000 for a brief period of time. But since then, prices have come down. I'm not going to talk about why the crisis happened. And prices came down, but what I would like to highlight that the prices kind of have settled down at a much higher level than what we had seen in many, many years before that, throughout the 90s and 80s. So the question is this a new support for rice price? Or are we going to see the $300, $200 rice price ever again? Or we are not, you know. But we, just like you can see, the rice price is kind of fluctuating between $500 and $600, which is much higher than what it was before the crisis and beginning of the century and throughout the 90s there. Although the prices in nominal terms have been rising for last many years, 6-7 years, because of the depletion of the stock level there. But the question is this a new floor for the rice price in the future? Do we actually decide what happens to the future from the 500 upward, or we actually going to see ever the $300 rice price in the future. Since the prices, what I would like to focus is, I call it a major shift in the food policy. In particularly among Asian countries, I think there's a new trend now, where basically countries are trying to achieve food security through food self-sufficiency. Okay? The whole idea is that you have enough food for all citizens by expanding domestic production. So you throw the import out of the equations there. So the countries are thriving to achieve the food security through domestic production, through having self-sufficient, the thing is, countries have done with lots of short-term measures, increasing the support prices. We have seen that in Thailand, India, Indonesia, many of the countries, the support price have increased after the crisis to expand the production. Lot of other short-term measures like input subsidies, fertilizer, seed, diesel to expand production. And finally, what I worry the most is the trade restrictions. The renewed interest on the trade restriction, countries have imposed the restriction both on the export and the import side to make sure that the domestic production stays at home. I think this is a very dangerous precedent in terms of if you look ahead in the future, where rice is already thinly traded commodity, only 5 to 7% of rice is traded, and if the Asian countries pursue the policy of self-sufficiency, then we might be getting into some lot of serious trouble in many years to come. Maybe a lot more price volatility, a lot more price spikes. Then, as I said, a lot of temporary policy measures have been taken by country to make sure that the rice produced domestically stays for domestic consumptions. Then also Eric mentioned about renewed focus on regional rice reserve. Again, I am very skeptical about the operation of the regional reserve. I think we need to go back and look in the history and see how many regional rice reserves have worked, how many national rice reserves have worked in a sense. Then we finally, which is also a very dangerous precedent, that more involvement of the government. What we had seen throughout the 90s and first part of the century, rice trade was becoming slowly liberalized. The government was getting out of the business, but they're back in the business again. Then Eric had this slide before, the world rice trade. I'm not sure. Well, what we have seen we have seen a significant expansion in rice trade in last 15-20 years. The trade increased from 10 to 30 million tons. But I think we need to give few more years to see exactly which direction the rice trade will move. Right now, you can see last 3 years it's been going flat, going sideways. I hope this is not the real trend now. I hope this trend is reversed and the rice trend is going to go back again, the upward trend, what we have seen in the past. Because the only way you can stabilize this market to expand trade, to allow rice to move across border. If we don't make that happen, there is no way we can achieve global food security. We can produce whatever we want, but rice needs to be traded across the border. If the trade needs to be expanded. Just looking ahead, 2020 and 2030, let me focus on the demand side. I think it's the consumption which determines the supply. As an economist, you will agree with me, it's not the vice versa. It's the consumption which will determine how much will supply. If you look at the global rice consumption, the red line you see, that's the per capita consumption in last 18-20 years. Then the area you see, that's the total consumption. You can see per capita consumption, this is total consumption, not food. Rice disappearance, rice utilization, you can say that, which is food, feed, seed, other uses, everything included in that. What you see, the historical data in last 20 years, per capita consumption has been flat, or slightly declining in recent years. You can see it's 64 kilograms throughout the 90s and last 8 years of this century. Only thing is the rice total consumption is increasing at the rate of population growth. If you assume this is constant or slightly declining, so whatever increase in total consumption we have seen, it's growing because of the population growth there. And if you look a little bit more carefully, although the globally the per capita consumption is flat, there are changes happening within Asia where 90% rice is consumed. You have seen significant decline in high income Asian countries, particularly Japan, Korea, Taiwan. And the thing is, you can see more than 50% decline in per capita consumption in Japan and South Korea and Taiwan in the last 30-40 years. I think the real question becomes whether the other Asian countries will follow the Japanese or South Korean or Taiwanese trend. If that is the case, I don't think we have to worry about rice food security. We are all set. But if you look at other consumptions, the other Asian country, this is just to tell some of the major Asian country, India, China, actually they're kind of 50-50 in terms of the rice and wheat. They're not only rice consumers, they're also major wheat consumers. And you can see some other countries, Vietnam and Bangladesh, they primarily consume rice. Then you can see some of these other countries, Indonesia, Philippines, with huge amount of rice but very moderate amount of wheat. The reason I'm showing this one, my point is that all these countries are unique. You cannot put all these Asian countries in the basket of China, Korea, Taiwan, or Japan, and think that as the income grows, they will behave exactly like those countries. The consumption pattern, the significance of rice, where the rice lies in each of the countries are different. So each of the countries, as they become richer, as they become industrialized, they will behave differently. Not exactly what we have seen in Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan. So it's pretty evident. You can see here, what I have here, the horizontal axis is your income, per capita income, and the vertical axis is the per capita consumption. You can see that each of the country have their own path. As the income going, they actually own path there. You can see Malaysia is pretty flat in between 1990 and 2005. In 15 years, their income has doubled. From $2,500 to $5,000, the per capita consumption more or less not much change. It's pretty much same. Then you can see other countries, India, China, where per capita income is much lower. You see some decline in the per capita consumption in these countries. Then on the other side, you see countries like Vietnam, Bangladesh, Philippines, even to some extent Indonesia, per capita consumption still rising. So you have a mixed bag of countries in Asia. Where the more high income country, their per capita consumption has declined. There are other mid income countries like Thailand, India, China, where per capita consumption started to decline. Then you have countries like Philippines, Bangladesh, Vietnam, where per capita consumption continues to rise. I think I don't think anybody knows what's the inflection point when all these countries going to turn around and start consuming less. We know that as the income grows, they are going to consume less, but it's when. That inflection point for each country is different. You cannot say that as soon as this country reaches $5,000, they will start consuming less rice. I think that's a very generalized statement. I think each country is going to behave differently, how they consume in the future, what happens to rice consumption in the future. Just to